Our short story tonight is about the British founder of the Boy Scout movement, Baden-Powell. Our setting is the occupied town of Mafeking, South Africa, 1899. There's a love triangle. Colonel Baden-Powell went to Mafeking, South Africa with his pal of many years, the boy. To occupy the town of Matabele, South Africa, in the middle of the British War against the Afrikaners, also known as the Boers, the Second Boer War, 1899. Chief Uwini was a Matabele war chief fighting against the British on the side of the Afrikaners, the Boers. He was thought to be divine. Chief Uwini. His warriors believed that if they fought bravely, that the white man's bullets would return to raindrops. Baden-Powell, he was a sketch artist, prolific writer. Much of our script, almost all of it, read by the boy, is from his Baden-Powell's journal entries, books, newspaper articles, and a mashup of actually found documents. He loved to spy. Baden-Powell did watch executions, stick pigs, act, and wear dresses, and
wants to read it? The page I won't read?
No.
Here.
I believe what happened with Baden-Powell and Chief Uwini, the story we tell tonight, motivated and haunted Baden-Powell for the rest of his life, and our short story, I think, embodies the theme of what I hope to be a larger one.
See?
Like a statue cast in bronze. His head turned from me, listening for any suspicious sound. Then, with swift and easy movement, He drank and drank as though he never meant to stop. And when at last his frame could hold no more, he rose with evident reluctance. He picked his weapons up and then stood again to listen. Hearing nothing, he turned and sharply moved away. Running from this place, from this beautiful savage, from myself, I found myself bursting with the intimations of what was to become the Boy Scout Oath.
On my honor, I promise. On my honor, I promise. On my honor, I promise to do my duty to God and the King and to help people at all times, no matter what it costs me, and to know the Scout Law and to obey it.
Martin Gaff writes a Pall Mall Gazette war correspondent and mafeking in a delightfully breezy letter to his paper. But some of us know that the gallant Colonel Baden-Powell is about as good a skirt dancer as any that ever walked down the house. And a few favored individuals who were invited to dine with him the other evening still talk of the many accomplishments with which he kept the sides of the room shape, and gained applause that made the hands of the porters feel sore next day. Some say he never sleeps, and I half believe the statement. He is a wonderfully tireless man, ever on the alert, ever with one eye on the enemy, and the other divided between the town and that nightmare that he was shot. The great Chief Uwini, the feared Matabele warrior, and his gang of rebel warriors dancing a dance of defiance. Both the sight and sound of them was intensely impressive, and the men looked so splendid they were, as a rule, fine, strong, muscular fellows with handsome faces. Their brown bodies were polished with oil, their heads were covered with ostrich plumes, whilst around their knees and elbows were fastened white cow's tails, a sign that they were on the warpath.
Ingoyama! Goyama!
Ingubu! Ingubu!
Yapo! Yapo!
Ingubu! Ingubu!
Ingoyama! Ingoyama!
Ingubu! Ingubu!
Yapo! Yapo!
Ingubu!
wait, but one and all they turned to fly, dodging in among the bushes, loading as they ran. And we were close upon their heels, zigzagging through the thorns, jumping up now and then, or pulling up to fire a shot. Presently, I came upon an open stretch of ground, and about 8 yards before me was Chief Uwini. I felt so indignant at this that I rode at him as hard as I could go, calling him every name under the sun. He aimed. For an hour, it seemed to me, and it was quite a relief when at last he fired at about 10 yards distance, and still more of a relief when I realized he had cleaned. Then he jumped up and turned to run, but he had not gone 2 paces when he cringed as if someone had slapped him hard. Shot by one of our men behind me. Brother Scouts, I ask you to make a solemn choice. Differences exist between the world and thought and sentiment, just as they do in language and physique. The war has taught us that if one nation tries to impose its particular will upon others, cruel reaction is bound to follow. The Boy Scout Jamboree has taught us that if we exercise mutual forbearance in give and take, then there is sympathy and harmony. Among our Boy Scouts and Girl Guides, there's not one who doesn't feel the bond of friendship and comradeship and brotherhood with those of other. War is how civilizations make life. When civilizations are at war, each side absorbs qualities of the other. Like lovers, they guide each other by compulsions they do not understand. So, two civilizations at war are engaged in an exchange so fundamental that neither consciously realizes its nature or extent. Be careful how you choose your enemy, for you will come to resemble him. The moment you adapt your enemy's methods, your enemy has won. The rest is suffering and historical opera. Sharply from rock to rock, and everything was silent again. A cloud of blue smoke rose heavily on the calm air, and the body of the savage chieftain lay prostrate and motionless on the ground over which he had once held a despotic and sanguinary sway. We all felt sorry to see a man shot who showed so much courage, who was wounded and a prisoner. And I believe Colonel Baden-Powell was as sorry as anybody. But his execution would undoubtedly produce immense effect on the native life. of proving to the rebels that their great chief was no god. The bullets turned the ring host, but he was merely a man like anybody else.
Thanks for coming. The first thing, we'll do popcorn, just say little things. I'm Steve Morgan Haskell, and I developed this piece. Maybe you see your name.
Oh, my
name is Nkechi.
Jan Sturman. Popcorn. An idea, an image, quick. Pop, pop.
As in questions, if you like.
One of the best skirt dancers.
I would like very much to hear about your choice of having a woman in that role. Very much I would like to hear about that. It was all I could think about the entire piece.
It's a really good question. Couldn't find somebody to play Baden-Powell, not actually an actor. And I had seen Nkechi on stage at the Inferno Theater doing something like recollect time. She was wonderful. And a freed slave who played a man and a woman. And I thought, I had many different stories I could tell. I had been researching for about 3 or 4 weeks. And I asked many actors to be in it. And I knew I'd tell the story depending on the actors that I'd be getting. And I asked her to be in the piece. And she said she would be in the piece. And so I told the Uwini story, using her and myself. Could very easily have been a man or a woman. Yeah, it's in a nutshell.
I can add to that. I was excited to play a man, and I was really looking forward to figuring out costuming that would suggest that I could be a man. But in working with the piece and looking at the different warriors, most of them were effeminate. I mean, there was a lot of, you know, kind of their eyes and their dress, you couldn't actually tell. I mean, they were always chest covered, and so it was really kind of interesting that maybe Uwini was a woman. We don't know. I mean, historically, I guess they say it wasn't, but a lot of the costuming at that time was, there was no way to really tell. So I found that as I was working on it, I became more feminine, and I don't know, I have no idea why, so.
Well, you talk about two people in war being almost like lovers, or two countries, so that made it interesting for me that you were a woman. Think about that.
I thought you were a very warrior,
like,
in the world.
I love the use of the coming up into the space. I love the sharp sounds, the percussive sounds that just kind of always disturbing the space with unknown, unexpected sounds.
Well, the image of her lying on your back at the end, just draped over you, and her hair coming down over your face, it's a beautiful image.
The whole comparison is the countries as lovers, and what was the line, like, you're taking from each other's compulsions? What's that the word?
What?
There's some really interesting word.
Yeah.
I thought it was interesting that even though you enjoy the character, and everyone seemed to enjoy the character, the chief, that being compelled to kill him, the sadness about being compelled to kill him seemed to be coming through, which is not something that's ever addressed, or I haven't seen addressed very often. So I thought that was unique.
It's a terrible thing that happened, and it just recently has come out. There were some journals written by some people who were at Matabele at the time, and these were sold on auction. So when I went on the internet, sort of Baden-Powell's Achilles heel. He came back to Great Britain in 1900, a war hero, truly a war hero. Britain was thinking that the British Empire is crumbling, and because he kept this town surrounded by wars, constantly being shelled, because he kept this town, he kept the town and used young men to be scouts and all that, because he kept that, he became a war hero, but he was also supposedly illegally executed, Uwini, and was taken to court for it. And he changed a journal entry of his, in the address that he actually changed a journal entry, changing the way Uwini was actually captured and the agreement that Uwini had made. It was one of those things where he rationalized it by saying, if he proves that the bullets don't turn into raindrops, then all the others will surrender. And it did serve a purpose that way, but it is awful. And my sort of conceit, my idea from my play, is that he was truly in love with him, truly deeply in love, and wanted to consume him, be with him. But he also couldn't deal with that and be a war hero and be what he wanted to be, what possibly his mother wanted him to be. So he had to destroy him. But in that same way, he's kind of destroyed a little bit of himself.
Was the journal of reading, was that straight from his journals, or did you take some liberty?
Yeah, go to the Baden-Powell. I did some things. There may have been some pieces here and there that I combined just to make the story flow. But almost all, go to the Baden-Powell Library. His journals are, he's a wonderful writer, sketch artist, and this guy is a Renaissance man. And almost everything is from his words. Some of the description of the Matabele warriors was from a book called The Matabele War, which I found, which another man wrote, whose name I don't know right now. But the skirt dancing article was from the Pall Mall Gazette in 1899. That was an actual newspaper article. You know, I hit that and I thought, we'll just read that, and maybe I'll be nothing, or maybe I'll learn a skirt dance, or maybe I'll wait and get an actor to learn that, or play, or something like that. How are you doing, Tom?
Four minutes?
Okay. I thought that you had nice presence, but the words that I was hearing and the actions I was seeing, I was hearing and seeing two different stories. And I wasn't sure if that was an intentional contrast. It was a wonderful bit of clowning there at the beginning. Don't know if that was intentional about your reading of what the story was to be, but for me it undercut what the story was about. That what I focused on was you're seeing nervousness, or not as a judgment, but this is as a clown, this is what I saw.
Yeah.
And that I didn't hear, like, I'm missing these words about this is about a war, but now I hear you crumpling up the paper, or now I'm interested in you giving it to this person. Yeah. So I liked the idea of presenting it in that way, but the tension lost for me setting up the story. Instead, I saw this actor.
I'm on your side, I believe in what you said, and I was, not forced, because I made the final decision, but through all my peers, you know, the first two times that we did it, I did not come out and give any exposition, I didn't explain anything. We just did the piece from the horns, he comes out, and we did the piece the first two times. Some people really liked it a lot, some people needed more. So we got together, I said, let's give them three things, and I spent all morning working on it, and I tried to play the student who didn't really want to do what he was doing when I first came out here, and I completely agree with you, and I won't, you know, and that's what happened. I did that for the first time ever, and yeah, so I agree with you.
Well, I'd love to see maybe if that's going to be part of it, that the three of you come out, because you're going to have a different relationship once the story starts, is all I'm saying.
And
if you want to be uncomfortable, like, I'm a woman, I'm playing a man, you know, acknowledge the tensions that are about to be part of it.
Yeah, thank you. I can't see you.
I was just thinking, perhaps the reluctant student who gives the exposition should be played by someone other than the one who plays Baden-Powell.
Yes. And when I do write this play, I'm going to write this play, it probably won't be done this way. It will be Baden-Powell will speak. Uwini will speak. There will be dialogue. There will be, I do see this story here as the kernel or the seed of something that is throughout the play. We kind of break it up at the very beginning of the play, throughout the play, sort of like he's making a decision in his life, and Uwini appears, and there's this moment. That's how I see this, and so I feel really lucky that I got the theme of the play, the sort of the spine of the play. But I don't think it will ever be done the way we did it. I did it because I didn't want to be in it, and I didn't want to talk or try to be Baden-Powell. And also Jan, my good friend Jan, who we're raising our kids together, not together, we're not partners, but he has a family out with them. He's from South Africa, and he set me straight on the Boer War and all that, and we were having dinner before I even started researching once, and he kind of set me straight on the politics of all that, and I didn't know anything about it. And I said, well, why don't you be my narrator? So I had him before I had Nkechi. I had Jan. I said, you're going to be my narrator, you're going to read things, I want people to know this stuff, so when you come to the play again in a few months, you'll have a sense of where I came from, what the story that I think that I really do believe haunted Baden-Powell, truly, and motivated him, what haunts you possibly motivates you. South Africa, Africa, Nigeria, South Africa. I was lucky.
And I can talk a little bit about the process that the movement, I think, really, I mean, because all the text hadn't been decided when we started on this. I mean, I think it was maybe a third or maybe even less than that fully put together. And through our various meetings and just kind of acting out what we were feeling, moving in space, the text started to match up with what we were doing. So I do believe there's kind of two stories being told. One is this kind of movement through space, which was its own story, and then there is the text, which is its own story, and then there's kind of our individual characters, which have their own journey. And I think I didn't know what to expect in 10 minutes. I mean, it seems like you communicated a lot, which is pretty cool. It was really a pleasure working with these guys and getting to kind of that core essence of the story, which was that's usually what war is about. It is about kind of this awkward love affair with a country, but raping and pillaging it, and then trying to, you know, incorporate it back into the culture, and that's kind of just a sad truth that you know, we got to expose while we were working on this.
We'll have to leave it there.
Thank you.
Thank you.